When consumers buy a product from a producer, there's a trade that takes place. The consumers are called the buyers, and they are responsible for the demand, and the businesses are responsible for the supply. Now, the great thing about this kind of trade is that there are actually two beneficiaries of this trade. There are two winners, assuming that the trade is voluntary. And the reason why there are two beneficiaries to this particular trade is that because it's voluntary, if both the buyer and the supplier don't benefit from the trade, then the trade wouldn't take place, assuming both parties are rational. Now, in this diagram, we can actually exactly identify and graph how much consumers are benefiting, and we can also graph how much producers are benefiting. That's going to be in the next graph. It's called producer surplus. But right now we're going to focus on how much the consumer surplus or benefit is from a particular trade. Well, first of all, let's take a look at this supply and demand curve. You can see an upward sloping supply curve, down sloping demand curve. The equilibrium for this particular product is at the intersection of the two curves, as you know by now. And so it's around $3. We get a quantity of about 40. So people are buying the product, assuming it's a free market, at $3. Now, if you look at this demand curve, you can see that there are people here at the demand curve who were willing to pay a lot more than $3 for this particular product. They were actually willing to pay about $5 or a little bit more than $5. So about close to 10 people were willing to pay $5. But the equilibrium price in the market was $3. So they actually are having a surplus compared to what they value the product at, which is what the demand curve shows. They're having a surplus of a little bit more than $2. Let's say $5.50 up here. $5.50 minus the actual $3 that they're paying. Now, there were a number of people, let's say here, that were willing to pay, looks like about $4.50. So they're getting a consumer, what's called a consumer surplus. So the consumer surplus is the amount that people are paying, $3, equilibrium, versus what they were willing to pay according to the demand curve. You can graph a couple more points on the curve here. This is closer to $4. And there were about 20-some people willing to pay that, and so forth, $3.50. And all the way down to the people that were willing to pay exactly $3. Of course, they're just about breaking even if they're paying $3. The consumer surplus, then, is the area that is, mathematically, it's the area that is between the blue lines. I'm going to graph, I'm going to make another blue line here. So this triangle here. Let's see if we can graph the exact area. And let's say that this area here inside this triangle mathematically is the area of the consumer surplus. Mathematically, you can calculate the how much the area is inside of this triangle. I think it's the length, half the length times the width. So in mathematics, you learn the exact amount the area of the triangle, and that is the consumer surplus. You might get some multiple choice questions that ask whether consumer surplus is rising if demand or supply increase. So let's say that we have let's graph demand curve, downward sloping demand curve, and let's graph an upward sloping supply curve. So we have demand here, and then we've got supply here. And then, of course, the price is on the vertical axis and the quantity is on the horizontal axis. And let's graph the consumer surplus again. This line here, we're going to extend the demand curve here a little bit. And this is the consumer surplus here. Now, what would happen if both demand and supply increase? What would happen to consumer surplus? So let's graph that situation. So let's increase the supply curve. So we're going to go from S1 to S2. And then let's increase the demand curve. And we're going to go from D1 to D2. Now, if you go to the, if you look at what the consumer surplus is for the two new curves, so So we're going to extend this line here. This is the new equilibrium. And extend that one up to the vertical axis so we can see what the, let's give it a little different color. We can see the new, what the new surplus is. And the, as you know, the area underneath this triangle now is the total consumer surplus. And as you can see, when you compare the two, the when you compare the blue area that we had at first and now the kind of burgundy area, we can see that consumer surplus has increased. So if both demand and supply increase, then we will see that the consumer surplus increases. Just one little quick little note about what consumer surplus is versus the regular surplus that we talked about before. So consumer surplus obviously is the thing that we just talked about, the area underneath the triangle. Regular surplus, and you know the terms are confusing. If I were to be the one that to make up these terms, I would have chosen a different term. But in any case, this is what they are. And regular consumer surplus is where, you know, when you had the equilibrium free market price right here, and the government set by law a price that is higher, for example, a minimum wage. And then we would have, this would be the P that was determined by the government. This is the equilibrium price. Let's call that the PEQ. So the government set price is up here. And this would create, oops, sorry about that. That's not very nice. This would create what we call a surplus up here. So that's different from consumer surplus. Terms sound same, but it's a different concept. And so there is a difference between consumer surplus or producer surplus that we're going to talk about later and surplus, just surplus by itself.